Well, hello and welcome to all of our campuses, those watching us here in Ann Arbor, those watching in Jackson, Michigan at the AMC Classic 8, and those watching online throughout the week on YouTube or podcasters or whoever you are. Come on, we're one church across multiple locations. So what I love to do as we begin the service is every week, let's give it up for our church family across all those spaces today. Yeah, I love it. I love it. Well, hey, thanks so much for being here today. My name is Jason Tucker, and I'm one of the pastors here that are very excited to welcome you to week number two of a series that we're calling Goliath Must Fall. It's a series about winning the battle against the giants in your life. And if you missed last week, it was the kickoff of this message series. I want to encourage you big time to go back, check out our YouTube channel, look for that message, week one of Goliath Must Fall, because I think it's a message that really is foundational for every week of this series. Last week was kind of a broad scope look, and this week is much more of a deep dive into one particular giant that we face in our life. Now, if you missed last week, it's okay, because obviously you can see the context of the story is one of the most famous underdog stories of all time, David and Goliath. Goliath must fall. We talked about this story in depth last week and where we find it in the Bible, but we really answered the question, how do giants fall? And that's a big deal, because that's really what we want to know in a lot of different areas and aspects of our lives, because all too often we're faced with things that are bigger than us. And we know dang well that they're bigger than us, but we're not exactly sure how to deal with them in life. How do I deal with my fear? How do I deal with anxiety? How do I deal with depression? Or, you know, how do I deal with anger? Or these things that time and time again, addictions, whatever it might be, that continue to show me that they're the giants in my life. They're bigger than me, and I really can't handle them on my own. Last week, we answered this question, and I said, really, David, in the story of David Goliath, was a type and shadow of Jesus, because on the day that David dealt with Goliath in that valley of Elah, he was a foreshadowing of Jesus. And the only good in David that day was a representation or a shadow of the good that was to come, the complete good that was to come in Jesus. Because obviously, like I mentioned last week, David was not a perfect person by any stretch of the imagination. He had his own fair share of shortcomings and failings. You name it, he had many different struggles and wrestling matches with his own insecurity, with his own giants, if you will. But on this particular day, I think David, in a shadow of Jesus, did an incredible job answering the question by acting like Jesus would when it comes to Goliath. He dealt with Goliath with the correct perspective. He looked at that giant that day, and he saw the giant for what it was. Yes, it's a 9-foot-tall giant, but hey, my God is bigger. And that's what we said last week. Having a perspective when it comes to your giants is understanding your struggle might be big, but your God is bigger. David also had a persistence when it comes to dealing with Goliath. He didn't just leave him dead on the battlefield. He carried that victory with him beyond that battlefield, even to go so far as to cut off Goliath's head and take it with him to the next city. David was persistent about this victory he had won, not for his own glory, obviously, but for God's glory. Persistence, because he knew that the battle that he won today might be leading him to another battle that he'll be facing tomorrow. I mentioned last week, some theologians say the reason David picked up 5 stones was because Goliath had 4 brothers. And it wasn't because David thought he was going to miss. It was because David knew that if he dealt with Goliath, he was going to have to deal with Goliath's brothers potentially. And I think there's definitely some merit to that speculation and that theory, because I think it applies to our lives too. If I deal with my anxiety, you better believe I'm going to have to tackle or wrestle with my fears at some point. If I deal with my addiction, you better believe that I'm going to have to wrestle with my own insecurity at some point. So winning the battle with our giants is about perspective, seeing things, even though they're big, my God is bigger, being persistent, knowing that whatever victories I win today are just leading me to new mountains tomorrow. But I think the key point last week, really, that I hope you took away was praise. And that's just simply that, that David didn't do what he did with Goliath in the valley that day for his own good, to beat on his own chest, to get the glory, to say, I overcame it. No, David did it because he wanted to see God get the glory. And I think that's what is important for us when it comes down to dealing with our own giants is, yes, getting the victory would be good for us, but a lot of times it's our giants that are standing in the way of God's glory being revealed in our lives. And David dealt with Goliath that day out of a heart of praise. So how do giants fall? Perspective, persistence, praise. You're going to see that a lot over these next few weeks. But today I want to really dive into this question. How does fear fall? You know, if we're talking about giants in general last week, this week I want to take a very specific look at fear. Now, you're probably in one of two categories. For most of you, some of you would say, well, I don't really fear anything. You know, I'm a thrill seeker, baby. Like, I I have no fears at all. And I would say, okay, well, maybe you'll feel a little bit different by the time we finish today, because I believe to some degree we all wrestle with fear. And in fact, it's a human characteristic that's been built inside of us by God, that fight or flight mentality. And fear to a certain degree is what keeps us alive. So there's a certain degree of fear that rests in us, but what's a healthy balance look like with that? And especially, what about the times when fear really has a hold of my life and is keeping me paralyzed, like it did in the story of David and Goliath for the nation of Israel? And it was very, very much that whole Biff Tannen moment, right? If you've never seen Back to the Future, it's probably because you're under 30, and I apologize for that, but you might want to go back, check out Netflix, and watch it, because the greatest villain, one of the greatest bullies of all time, Biff Tannen, is exactly what the scene is. It's this moment where, you know, McFly, what are you doing? And where the nation of Israel has been tormented so much that they're living in a fear of the bully, or a fear of what's going on. And that fear, that reverence for Goliath being tall, there's a respect to go, man, this is going to be a big battle. This is a big giant. But it went beyond that. It was paralyzing, because for 40 days, the Bible says that Biff Tannen bullied them around on the side of a hill. Not just one person, an entire nation was bullied around by Biff Tannen, or Goliath. We pick it up in the story here. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, to the entire army, why do you come out and line up for battle? Like, are you really going to fight me? You really want a piece of this? Hello, McFly. Am I not a Philistine, and are you not the servants of Saul? Choose a man and have him come down here. If he's able to fight me and kill me, we'll become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us. Goliath throws down a big challenge, and look what happens. On hearing the Philistine's words, Saul, the king of Israel, the most fierce warrior up till that point that Israel had ever seen as a nation, one of the most respected warriors, their leader, their king, and all of them, the people that went along, all the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. Fear overtook them. They were frozen by their fear. Later on in the story, it goes on to say that whenever the Israelites saw the man, I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man, right? Whenever the Israelites saw the man, whenever Biff Tannen walked onto the scene, they all fled and ran away in what kind of fear? Great fear. They ran away in a great fear, not a healthy fear, not a, you know, like a built-in survival kind of respect of, you know, a fearful respect of certain things. But no, they ran away in a great fear, a paralyzing fear. And I think all too often that's a great parallel of our lives. In fact, I would go as far as to say, I think in society today, we've developed that idea a little bit more. We've added additional words to fear, like the word anxiety, where if you really look at these two things by definition, they're very closely related. Fear is an emotion that stems from, this is a Webster definition, that stems from the uncertainty of potential loss. Like, I'm scared that I'm going to lose something, maybe my life. I'm scared I'm going to lose my dignity. I'm scared I'm going to, lose the argument. I'm scared I'm going to lose this marriage. I'm scared I'm going to lose my children. I'm scared, whatever it is, there's an emotion that rises up inside of us from the uncertainty of potential loss. Well, anxiety is a feeling, fear is an emotion. Anxiety is a feeling of excessive uneasiness. Like, it's excessive. I'm just uneasy and I'm apprehension, and it's rooted in the uncertainty of potential loss. Again, I'm feeling uneasy. I'm feeling apprehensive about a situation in my life where I feel like, or I'm worried about experiencing some kind of loss. Now, what many people would say is, you know, hey, if I just knew that I wasn't going to lose something, if I could just see the future and kind of know, you know, what was behind the door, if you will, right? You know, then I wouldn't have any fear, or I wouldn't have any anxiety. If I could just have it labeled for me, right? As I have to walk through these potential doors in life, hey, if you walk through this door, it's not going to be scary at all. You have nothing to fear. Walk through that door, it's going to be really scary. And on the end, it's very scary. So you can kind of choose your level of fear, right? Well, there's some degree of thought that if I could just know what the outcome would be, then I wouldn't have fear in my life. But I think we see in scripture, and I think when we really boil this down in our own lives, we know and we find out that that's not really true. It's not so much about peeking on the other side of the door or knowing what's on the other side of the door. Like, if I creep the door open and I can just peek over there and see, like, oh, it's not so bad what's on the other side of that door. No, Israel as a nation, they had experienced this before, because the fight that they were experiencing that day with Goliath was a fight that they had over and over again. See, the Philistines were a problem for them on many different occasions, not just on one. And they knew that they were going to run into trouble with them. In fact, as God told them to go to the promised land, to inhabit the promised land and really inherit those promises that he wanted to give them, they sent out spies to the land, 12 spies, to go look and see, hey, go see what's behind the door. Go see what we're getting into. And if we have anything to fear or worry about behind the doors, watch what happens. The spies come back and say, we went to the land where you sent us, and it really is a land flowing with milk and honey. In other words, those promises, God, that you made us, they're incredible. Yes, we believe that we can live a life beyond fear. We believe that we can live a life where we have peace in situations where we don't have peace, and where our anxiety, our apprehension can be pressed back. We believe those things to be true. We've seen that they might be able to be true, but, even though I've seen behind the door, the people who live there are strong. They're strong. He said, and the cities and the walls have walls that are very big. The spies came back and said, the cities have walls that are huge. And we even saw the descendants of Anak there. Now listen, that's a reference to Goliath. This happened obviously prior to the David and Goliath story, as Israel is walking into or inhabiting the promised land for the very first time. But even then, on their first step into the promised land, they said, we've seen that the descendants of Anak are there. And Anak's descendants were affiliated with the Nephilim or the giants that were in the land. And so they had already seen giants. They already knew there were giants there. So how much perspective does that bring to this story? It comes across so differently than it did when I was in Sunday school and church, and when they gave me a picture of David and Goliath to color, and I just, you know, and they told me, you're Goliath. But to look at this in context, Israel had seen these giants before. They had seen these Nephilim before. They had dealt with these walls, these high walls in these cities. They had dealt with strong armies and strong people. They'd seen it. They'd been behind the door. They said, the spies said, the Amalekites live there, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites, and the Canaanites. Like, they're all there. All these people are there. And we have to go drive them all out. And out of the 12 that they sent out that day, 10 of them said, we shouldn't go. We should not go. It's not going to end well. But only two said, no, we should go. We should go in the power of the God that is sending us. See, seeing behind the door really doesn't change our perspective on fear. It doesn't make us not fear or make us fear less. It's just a different kind of fear. We have to manage it differently, right? Remember the show Fear Factor back in the day? Joe Rogan. A ridiculous show, in my opinion, but always intriguing. Whenever I passed by it, it always caught my attention and I had to watch for a minute. Why? Because it was like a dumpster fire happening right in front of your eyes. And I think Israel kind of parallels this in this story. The nation of Israel, they've kind of been walking this out. They've seen this fear. They've looked at it eye to eye. And I think Fear Factor was all about making you really look at it eye to eye. It didn't change the fact when they knew that, and the contestants knew what they were getting into, that they were freaking out, right? When they had to jump into the snake pit, right? You had to look at the snake pit. They did such a good job of playing that music. I'm sorry, I know it's Sunday morning and some of you probably don't want to look at bees and spiders and snakes, but go with me here. They set this up by this dramatic thing that, you know, you would see the snake cage and you would have to get into the snake cage and it would be a clear glass and have dramatic music to really stir up that fear. And even though you saw that happening in the midst of that cage, it didn't make it any easier to get in and let spiders crawl on your face. It didn't make it any easier to get in and let bees crawl on your face just because you saw what was behind the doors. And a lot of times it's a misconception that we have. I wouldn't fear if I could just see what was going to come, if God would just show me the outcome. Here's the problem. God sometimes knows what the outcome is that's coming. He knows there might be a situation that you have to walk through in your life that's going to be like bees on the face. But he knows that he's going to walk you through it. And he knows that you seeing that is not going to do you any good to know what's happening down the road. Like, I wouldn't fear if I just knew what was coming. No, that's not really true. We're going to face it. We're going to be having to understand it. And that's really what I want to try to help you with today. As I studied this week, is really try to understand this. What are the roots of our fears then? If that's the case, if fear isn't about necessarily like knowing the future, it's not about seeing the imminent things that are coming and being able to prepare myself for them. What is the root of fear? And I really came to three conclusions this week as I kind of thought about this, prayed about it, and studied about it. I think the first thing is conditioning. I think the root of fear in our life a lot of times is conditioning. Let me tell you what I mean by that. I think depending on the environment we were brought up in, depending on how we dealt with certain situations in our lives previously, we've learned some things and we've been conditioned in a certain way towards fear. Like, for example, if you grew up in a household that just always was like, well, the hits just keep on coming, right? Like, if something bad could happen, it will happen. Or, you know, man, if it could it get any worse? And anytime those words come out of somebody's mouth, you're like, don't say that. You're going to jinx us. Like, don't, like, are you crazy? Like, don't, that's nutso. And that fear inside of you, you've been conditioned a certain way. I think the root of fear is how your experiences have led you up to today, whether they've been handled correctly or incorrectly. Those experiences make you who you are when it comes down to fear. And all of us have a root, a conditioning of fear to a certain degree when it comes to our lives. We've been conditioned in a certain way to deal with fear. I'm hoping today we can overcome that conditioning or take a step towards overcoming it and dealing with our fears in a new way. The second thing is concealing. This is one that not a lot of people think about when you're talking about fear, but the reality is for all of our lives, there's a degree of hiding that's going on. There's a degree of I'm not able to be completely myself around other people because I have to hide some things because I'm scared that if they really saw me for who I was, what would they think? Or maybe it's for some of you, maybe you're hiding an addiction today. And the fear of being found out is crippling you. For others, maybe you're hiding a decision that you've made in your past. And you're trying to figure out how, maybe if you just conceal it and you keep it quiet, that fear and anxiety related to it will go away. But I'm telling you today, that's a root of fear. Hiding is one of the roots. Concealing things is one of the roots of fear in our lives. Conditioning is a root. Concealing is a root. Hiding is a root. But I think also controlling is a big root of fear for all of us. Now, when we started, I said, you know, hey, what do you fear? You know, if we all have fears, do you fear? And many of us probably thought, well, I don't know. I mean, I'm not really scared of too much. But when you think about it through this lens, all of us have had a degree of experience with fear up till now. All of us, probably with some regard in life, have something that we're not quite comfortable with about ourselves, something that we're hiding maybe, or something that we're concealing. Maybe we even think we're concealing it from God. But I think probably the one that definitely hits home with all of us would be controlling, because we live in a world today that reminds us on a daily basis that we're out of control. The world is spinning out of control all the time, and we can't control the situations that happen around us, the stories we hear on the news about mass shootings, or the fact that they say that the world is, the earth is spinning on its axis at about 1,000 miles per hour in order to make one rotation around in a 24-hour day. Like, if you think about some of these things that you absolutely have no control of in your life, no control. One of the weirdest things for me always, whenever I'm sitting outside, this is so weird. I know, go with me on this. But anytime a plane flies over outside, if I'm being 100% honest, what I feel like I can't control about that is, I always think in my head, this is how weird I am, I think in my head, all the bolts and nuts and screws that put that thing together, and if one of them fell out of that plane just at the right time as it was flying over my head, I have no control over that. But there is this degree, it's like, you know, you kind of have some apprehension, or it kind of takes your breath away. Controlling, or not being able to control the situation that you're in, is a root of fear inside of all of us. Now, when you think about this, and you look at these three things in context of what you see in God's Word in the Bible, what you're going to find out is these are pretty normal throughout Scripture. That a lot of times when fear was present, it was based on the condition of how people had dealt with it in the past, or that there was hiding, there was a concealing going on, or potentially there was a lack of control. They didn't feel in control. They didn't know who was in control. In fact, they felt completely out of control. But interestingly enough, throughout the narrative of the Bible, we see this truth, and that's God often puts our greatest victories in life on the other side of our greatest fears. I want you to think about that for a second. Why does God do that? God often puts our greatest victories in life, David and Goliath. He put David's greatest victory on the other side of an entire nation's greatest fear. Maybe he's doing that in your life today. Maybe for some of you, just the idea of God in general scares you to death. You're not sure about God. You don't know exactly how to navigate that. And you're wondering maybe even where the truth and kind of the reality of all that fits into your life. God often puts your greatest victories on the other side of your greatest fears. I would encourage you today that I think as you seek this out, I hope you know this is a church that we take pride in being a place where you can kick the tires and figure that out, because we believe this is true wholeheartedly. Well, for some of you, it's an addiction that you're struggling with and you're not sure how to beat it. You've tried to beat it. You took good notes last week, perspective, persistence, praise, but you're still staring this thing down with great fear in your heart because you're thinking, what would my life be like without it? The potential of loss and the apprehension and all that. But for some reason, God keeps leading me up to this fear. For some reason, the fear of losing my marriage, it scares me to death. But God keeps bringing us back to that fear, to face up to that fear. For some reason, my anger, the insecurity of tomorrow or what life might look like later, out of my control. how my kids will be once they grow up. All these things that we have zero control over. Like driving down the road today, will I get in a car accident? Am I doing okay health-wise? When I go to the doctor, that fear, that anxiety, that apprehension that raises up inside of us, why is it that God seems to like to leverage that? Why does God use that? Because see, if we look at fear through that lens, there's something extremely powerful about this that God must be wanting to show us, to teach us, to help us with in life. If our greatest victories often lie on the other side of our greatest fears, there must be a reason. And I would propose to you today that I think it's this: what I fear the most is usually where I trust God the least. What I fear the most is usually where I trust God the least. The areas of my life, the uncertainty of my future, I might lose my job this week. The boss is kind of angry at me, and you know, I got to keep up, you know, trying to put this front on, or I got to hide what I don't love about myself, what scares me to death. It's the areas that we fear the most where I think we trust God the least. And if we really look at what our journey with God is, it's this journey of God understanding that this is the balance that you bring to the table when you come to Him. For all of us, when we came to God, this was the balance that we walked. When we came to God for the first time, when we heard what Jesus did on the cross for us, we walked into that conversation, that relationship, with this being the state of our lives. Fear was bigger than our faith. We didn't have faith. We didn't know exactly even what faith was, because a lot of times we think that the antithesis of fear is courage, right? Just have more courage. Just be tougher and get through it, and man, you got this. But listen, I want to tell you today, I believe the antithesis of faith or fear is faith. This is the journey God is taking us all on. That's why the Bible says in 1 John 4:18, there is no fear. There's no fear. Fear is erased in love. Love is what erases fear when we understand God's love. Perfect love drives out fear. The more perfect our understanding of God's love, the fear is driven out of our lives. So that big thing we came in with, that big giant fear, begins to diminish. Why? Because fear has to do with punishment. It has to do with loss. But the one who fears is not made perfect in love. This is the journey we're on, is the more perfectly we understand God's love, the less we have to fear in life. That's why God leverages our fears. That's why God took the nation of Israel up to the edge of the Red Sea. That's why God put Goliath in front of the nation of Israel. That's why God walked Israel up to the walls, the tall walls of Jericho, and said, don't throw a rock, pull a sword or anything. Just walk around this place seven times and I'll get the victory for you. Because God wants us to understand His love for us. And He knows the more we understand His love, the less we will have to fear. And then the balance becomes this: our fears are diminished as our faith gets bigger. Our fears are diminished as our faith gets bigger. Now, you know me, I love practical teaching. So I want to help you on that journey. I want to help you practically take these steps this week in your life. I want you to go on this journey where you might be walking into this week with a giant sized fear. I want you to know God wants to leverage that fear. He wants to diminish that fear and increase your faith. That's the journey He's trying to take you and I on in our lives. And I want to help us understand, how do we do it? How do we do it? How does the giant of fear fall in our lives? Come on, I'm going to write these down. This is going to be, I'm hoping, some refrigerator material for you this week as you really walk this out practically in your life. The first thing is, I said it last week, perspective, persistence, praise. We're staying right there. The first thing is perspective. I've got to identify the root of my fear. I've got to identify the root of it. I got to know where it's coming from. If I can't give it a name, I really can't tackle it. I can't address it. So what is it for you? Is it conditioning? Is it your past? Is it, you know, that you grew up in a household or an environment where it was always, what's the next worst thing that's going to happen? And, you know, man, if, you know, it can only get worse. And is it the conditioning and how you've dealt with fear in the past? Is it the concealing? Is it something that you're hiding in your life that you don't really want to let out, whether it's between you and God or between you and other people? Is there something there? You know, for some of us, you know, whatever those addictions are that we've struggled with in the past, whether it's substance abuse or pornography or, you know, who knows what it is. The list is long, but concealing those things is really just, it's feeding that root. It's making that fear grow. And if we really want to see that giant fall, we got to get to the root of this. How about controlling? For many of us, that's the root. It's just that it's this lack of control that we have. And we wonder, you know, man, I just wish I had more control over the situation. But again, we're reminded on a consistent basis that our giants are big. They're bigger than us. But perspective is everything. I've got to define what the root is. I got to get a good look at the root of it. I got to take a step back and get a higher altitude. I even got to ask God, God, can you help me understand what it is? What's the root in my life today? What is it? Is it my past? Is it how I've been conditioned to deal with faith? Is it that I'm hiding something, God? Is it that I'm trying to control the situation too much? Listen, the book of Psalm in the Bible is incredible for a lot of reasons, namely because you see people doing this very thing, identifying the root of their fears. But what I love about the book is talking about David and Goliath. David is responsible for about 73 of the 150 plus that are Psalms that are written in that book. A lot of these moments of perspective, persistence, and praise are following a pattern that David is walking us through. And that's why most of what I want to share with you today in scripture is just that. Psalm 3, 1 through 8, you might have heard many of these in the past, but this is David talking. He said, Lord, how many are my foes? Like, I feel like how many people are actually against me right now? How many rise up against me? Many are saying, not just a few people, many people are saying, God will not deliver you. David's getting to the root of his fear. He's saying, this is the conditioning that I'm dealing with. This is what's going on. People are telling me this about my life. These are things maybe inside of my heart, God, that I haven't been honest enough to tell you. Even though you know these things, I've been hiding them. I've been concealing my feelings from you on these things. Or maybe, God, the reason I'm bringing these to you about my foes and the people that are rising up against me and the people that are saying that you'll not deliver me is because I feel like things are spinning out of control. David's digging down into the root of his fear. And he says, but you, Lord, you're a shield around me. You are the shield around me. You're my glory and the one who lifts my head high. The one who lifts my head high. I cried out aloud to the Lord and he answered me from his holy hill. Look at this. I laid down and I slept. Man, how many of us are dealing with situations in our lives that are keeping us up at night? Where we're staring at the ceiling. I mean, in this case right here, David wrote most of these Psalms from a cave where he was running for his life from Saul and or the Philistines. At one point in one of the passages, he had been captured by the Philistines who he had killed Goliath. And so he knew they wanted to kill him. These are things that David is going through in his story. He's dealing with these fears in his life and he's getting to the root of these things. He's saying, but at the root, when I get to the root, when I talk about the root, look what I can do. I can lay down and I can sleep. I can rest when I get to the root of the matter. And then I wake up again for the Lord sustains me, even though they want to kill me, even though I might lose my job, even though there are so many things about life I can't control. There are so many things I feel like hiding from other people that I'm scared to show other people. There's so much of a past that I've been conditioned to do. I bring all those things, God, I dig them out at the root. And that helps me sleep at night. And not just sleep at night, I wake up again the next morning because you're sustaining me, God, every step of the way. David had perspective in his life. We need to have perspective when it comes to dealing with our fear at its root. The second thing is we need to have persistence. What's persistence look like? When it comes down to your fear, once you've given it a name, once you've identified it, you need to transfer ownership of it. You need to transfer the ownership of that fear. Give it away. I don't think it's a coincidence at all that in the Bible, 365 times we're commanded to fear not. Fear not. Don't be afraid. Don't be dismayed. Don't have any fear. And 365 is the number of days in a year. And I'm a firm believer that God has a sense of humor when it comes down to those things, because he knew that you're going to need a reminder of some kind, a persistence about dealing with your fear on a daily basis. This isn't something you're going to just tackle and walk away from. No, this is something that's going to need a lot of persistent management. You're going to need to identify it, and then you're going to need to transfer ownership of it. I've got to give this away. This isn't my fear to handle. It's not mine to deal with. The giant that day that David dealt with, Goliath, he said, I'm going to deal with you because you're defiling God's glory. I'm here to deal with you on that behalf, on that truth, not because I just want a piece of you and I think I'm bad enough to take you. No, I'm going to deal with you because it's God's glory that's at stake. And David was persistent in that. And we need to be persistent in that as well. The Bible encourages us. 1 Peter 5:7, cast all your anxiety on him. Cast it on God. Why? Because he cares for you. Remember, the more that you cast it on God and you allow God to take that from you, you transfer the ownership of your fear. You get perspective, you identify it, then you persistently take it and say, this is bigger than me. I don't want to handle this, God. I'm letting you handle this. I know what it is. I'm letting you handle it. I know what it is. I'm letting you handle it. I know what it is. I'm letting you handle it. The more that you're doing that, the more that you're really understanding that God cares for you. See, it's the times when we identify it, we find out, we know what scares us to death, but we're not willing to transfer it over, that God's sitting there with open hands going, give it here. Give me that. I want to take that. And we're going, yeah, but God, I want to really try to figure this out. I want to deal with this on my own and I want to walk through this. No. That's persistence is how we deal with our fear. We've got to cast our cares on God. Listen, David said this in Psalm 16:8-9. He said, I've set the Lord always, always, always before me. In other words, whatever it is in my life, I'm going to a meeting later, I set the Lord before me. I got to make a phone call that I'm really nervous about or I'm anxious about, I set the Lord before me. I have to go talk to my financial advisor because I've made some poor choices, or maybe I didn't make poor choices and life just happened out of my control. I set the Lord before me. I'm going to set the Lord before me in all things, whatever it is, my addiction, my anger, my depression, my fear, my anxiety, all things. I'm putting the Lord always before me. And look what happens. Because he's at my right hand. In other words, God is right there with me. I shall not be shaken because of that. I'm not going to be fearful because of this. Why? Therefore, my heart is glad. Why? Because I identified it, but I didn't carry it around. I didn't leave it heavy on my heart. No, I got perspective, and then I persistently transferred ownership. I see that I have this fear. God, I need you to take this fear and do something with it. And with that, my heart is glad. My whole being rejoices, and my flesh dwells secure. Man, God, I'm really getting it. The more I bring it to you, the more I always put you before me, that's where my heart's glad. That's where I just have a rejoicing inside of my life. And that's where my life dwells secure. It's a great analogy of fly fishing. I don't know if you've ever been fly fishing, but one of the most incredible things about being a good fly fisherman, or important things, is about being a good caster. You've really got to be incredible at casting. And a lot of times when we're dealing with fears, whether it's, again, from conditioning, our past, concealing what we're hiding, or what we can't control, controlling, it requires multiple casts. Like, to be a good fly fisherman, it's all about casting continually, putting it exactly where you need to put it. I'm going to put the bait in the target strike zone. I'm going to transfer ownership to God. I'm going to continue casting. It's not just one cast and leave it out there and let it float down the river. No, that's not how it works. You have to continually do it over and over again. I saw this quote this week from Hudson Taylor. He was one of the first missionaries to China, and it said this: it doesn't matter how great the fear is. You see, a lot of times, like, we're looking at and dealing with great fear, in our life. But it doesn't matter how great the fear is. What really matters is where the fear lies, where you're putting it, what you're doing with it. Are you keeping it in your hands or are you putting it in God's hands? Whether it comes between you and God, right? It's if it becomes a wedge between you and God, where God's going, here, give me that. And you're holding on to it like, no, I need to deal with this myself. Like, then it becomes a wedge between you and God. It causes us to turn away from God instead of turn towards him and hand it over to him. Or whether it presses you nearer to his heart for you. It doesn't matter how great the fear is. What really matters is where the fear lies. Whether it comes between you and God or whether it presses you nearer to his heart for you. If I'm going to deal with my fear, if fear is going to fall in my life, I got to get perspective. I got to give it a name and really get to the root of it. But then I got to be persistent about transferring ownership to God. But again, I think the most important piece of all this is our praise. I've got to affirm my trust in spite of what's happening in my current situation, in spite of my fear, in spite of what my situation might look like right now. I need to affirm my trust in God. And that's what I think practically you could do this week and I can do this week, is affirm our trust in him even before we see the resolution of our fear. Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd." This is David talking. "I lack nothing. He makes me lie down." Like, he tells me, chill out, relax, put it in my hands, take a nap, okay? Put it in green pastures. "He leads me beside quiet waters." He leads me beside quiet waters. "He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake." Look at this. Here's the key. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, God, because you're with me. David is saying, before I even get to that dark valley, and even in spite of the fact that I'm going to have to walk through some things that are tough to walk through, I'm going to trust you because you are with me. That's where we're affirming our trust in him in spite of our fears. And I think that's so big. Like, when it comes to our worship every Sunday, when we sing songs at the beginning of the service, it's not just for the purpose of going through the ritual of singing some songs. No, our worship is powerful because fear and faith cannot occupy the same space at the same time. Fear and faith cannot occupy the same space at the same time. They're like oil and water. They cannot. You can shake them up. You can do whatever, but they naturally have a tendency to separate. And that's what our praise is. It's dispelling out all that junk, the fear that's in our life, and it's professing our faith in God alone. Those songs that we sing, they're powerful for a reason. I think about this song, and as we close out the service today, I want to encourage you this week just to be playing worship music throughout the week, creating a playlist maybe on Spotify or a resource of some kind to remind you of this, that my fear and my faith can't occupy the same space. So I'm going to affirm my trust in God today, even though I've got a valley to walk through. I'm going to affirm that, God, you are the one that's going to handle this, not me. You are big enough to handle this. And I'm not going to let that fear occupy anything that's coming out of my mouth. No, I'm going to let my praise be all about affirming my trust in you in spite of my fear, no matter what it is. Like, just think about this. Even when you just hear this song, and you listen to the words of this song is about Israel and their walk around Jericho and that moment where they're not sure where God's going to come through. 4 laps, 5 laps, 6 laps around a city, dealing with their own fear and the ridicule and everything else that they were dealing with at that time as a nation. Your life, same thing. But when you hear this song, just listen to these words. Let them minister to your heart today. Listen.
I see you do it again. I've seen you move. still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never.
When I think about those words in that song, it's just hard not to be encouraged no matter what's going on. That song was, again, that's written about Israel's walk around Jericho. And man, a powerful worship tune like that. I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe I'll see you do it again. You haven't done it yet, but I know that you're going to do it again. You're going to help me with this fear and this anxiety that I'm feeling in my life. You're going to help me with my past, what I've been conditioned to, how I've dealt with in the past, or what I'm concealing today, or the lack of control that I'm feeling, the issues and things going on in my lives. I've seen you move. You've moved the mountain. I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. Remember, our greatest victories in life are often on the other side of our greatest fears, because this is the journey God is taking us on today, church. As we close out the service, I really hope that really this moment this week that you're encouraged to man, dig in practically, to get some perspective on what it is that's crippling you in terms of your fear. To be persistent after you've identified it, to transfer ownership of it, to give it to God. And then on top of all of that, go ahead and affirm your trust in Him right in the middle of it. Even though I walk through a dark valley, I will fear no evil because you are with me, God. You are shrinking my fear and increasing my faith. Fear must fall. Let me pray for you today. God, thank you so much for your word. It's truth. It's life to us. I pray for everybody today that's watching this message, that's taken in a service at North Rock this weekend, that you would help us with our fear. You would help us understand how this giant falls in our life, and you would move powerfully this week and practically in our lives. We love you. We thank you for your truth. It sustains us. Help us get in our Bibles this week to be on the YouVersion Bible app together, digging into your word every day, looking for these truths to hang on to. Give us perspective, God, on the roots of our fear. Help us be persistent in bringing it to you and transferring the ownership to you. And give us the courage, God, to affirm our trust in you in spite of our fear, that even though we're walking through a tough situation, we have nothing to fear because you're with us. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,